All right, let's start it off.
This is the real estate investment.
Pretty much. This is how not to make money. my name is Mark Verbos. I'm a synthesizer builder. I'm a recording engineer, music producer, and I've been making electronic music since maybe 1988 or something like that. And along the way, I've worked as a recording engineer in a pro studio. I've assisted and interned in building synthesizers, and I made many, many records as either engineer or the artist in electronic music. I don't remember what I called the lecture. I think I called it Techno and the Analog Synthesizer, but what? Oh yeah, well that's what I called it on there, but I think outside it was called the Techno Synthesist. But I'd like to throw out the analog portion of it anyway, because I don't really care about analog and digital, and that's not really the point. What I want to talk about is about the history of electronic dance music, specifically techno, and how it relates to synthesizers, and the history of the music being connected in some ways to the synthesizers that were being used, and how the synthesizer was essentially written out of techno, and then kind of as a synthesizer builder, and as people who are here are maybe builders and some of you are users and whatever, about what the future holds, like if techno is going to have synthesizers ever again, or if it's just going to be a laptop thing. So to start with, that the idea of techno as a kind of music developed in the mid-80s, and people will say that it started in 1984, and Juan Atkins made the first techno record, but really, that wasn't music like we now call techno. That was more like electro. And that music was directly influenced by Kraftwerk and P-Funk and disco and a lot of different kinds of music that were to varying degrees electronic, but it was the first time when music for dancing was specifically trying to be electronic and robotic. And that by the time that it started to catch on as a movement by the late 80s, all of the instruments that were being used were being bought in pawn shops for $50 or found in a closet somewhere. Nothing that was being used to make that music was actually current. So I would say that a big turning point in this music was in 1987 when the house music became called, or the new kind of house music became called acid, which was entirely based on the TB-303, which was released in 1981, and nobody bought it. So this was a device that was intended to make bass lines, and bass lines that come out of it sound nothing like an actual bass. And the crazy, squelching, farting sounds that come out of it invented, several years later, a genre of music. But that didn't really do anything for Roland, who essentially gave them away by the end of the product cycle. And then everything started to change, where all of these people who were making this music and started to catch on were buying these old synthesizers. So by the time that I was involved in the music, the magazine, like if you read Keyboard magazine, there was an interview with somebody who made some kind of electronic dance music. They list off 50 synthesizers that they had in their studio, all of which were from the late 70s or early 80s, but nothing that was currently on the market. So everything that was actually actively being used to make that music was forgotten technology, stuff that the only reason that it was ending up in their hands was because it was cheap and because it had been discarded. But in the beginning of the 90s, in the music that we like to call techno, I could call this lecture How Jeff Mills Invented Techno, but really, I always say that all the major genres of modern techno were invented by Jeff Mills. And really, in the beginning of the 90s, when he was doing Underground Resistance and he was doing his very first Axis records, it was all synthesizers. It was all old synthesizers, but it was synthesizers. And he was using a TB-303, and he was using getting more toward cheap digital synths. He used this TG-33 when he made a record called Cycle 30, and he said in an interview, the reason that he used this was to show that you didn't have to have old analog synths to make techno, that you could use any piece of junk. Well, it definitely is a piece of junk, but why would he choose it? Well, because he probably bought it for $50 in a pawn shop, and it also had a really, really obvious control on the front, an interface that allowed him to reach out and tweak it and get something really quickly that had some variation, which really was the same thing as why this was popular before it, because there were a limited number of controls, a really basic interface that allowed you to do pretty dramatic tweaks to the sounds without digging through menus, without resorting to someone else's library of presets or whatever. So I'm from Milwaukee, Wisconsin, which is close enough to here in Chicago. And in those days, 92, 93, everybody that I knew was in a mad dash to try to collect as many old synthesizers as they could. And you could buy these things for nothing, practically. So we'd have ads in the newspaper that we were looking for, you know, a list of old synthesizers. And I bought that TB-303 for $100, and many others, like not just 303s, but SH-101s and MC-202s and Korg MS-20s and all this kind of stuff. But at that point, again, all really old, really cheap, really forgotten kinds of technology, and there was no one in 1993. I'm pretty sure there was nobody making an analog synthesizer at all, even though all the music that was actively getting exciting at the time was using them. And then a few companies came out with devices that were basically intended to copy this stuff, like the Novation Base Station or the Deep Base 9. And that doesn't actually solve any sort of problem, in my opinion. It doesn't move music or music technology forward to replace the old synthesizer with something that's just like it, but in a rack space instead of on a tabletop or whatever. And the secret that made this device so interesting was the sequencer. And none of those devices had the sequencer anyway. It just were a MIDI controlled device. But despite all of the techno artists at the time in the early to mid 90s, like, who were real analog synth people, like Basic Channel in Berlin, or Downwards Records guys in Birmingham, UK, or even people here in Chicago, or Drop Bass Network in Milwaukee, where, you know, I was associated with. You know, our studios had 25 old synthesizers, but nothing that was currently being made. And then pretty quickly, some people from in Europe mostly started to just use samples, like taking little pieces of either the synthesizers that were being made before, or taking little pieces of other records or whatever, and really developing a much more polished and produced sound by not actually sound designing in the way that we traditionally had been trained to do. So by that point, you see artists like LFO and 808 State became superstars, but their music is entirely based on samples. Most of it's samples from other records, but also samples of synthesizers. And then the rise of European underground techno names like Kari Lekkebusch or Adam Beyer, guys coming from Sweden, who were synthesizer guys, but by this point were just developing sample libraries and using a sampler. So entire records coming just out of like an Akai BC-3000 or an S-1000, and the synthesizer started to die. At this point, remember that there was not a single modular manufacturer that was actually out in the industry. So somebody like me who got in deep into synthesis in the early days of what I was doing, from the beginning was using synthesizers, it didn't have, the only opportunity that we had to get our hands on devices that were very techno-oriented or very machine-oriented, it didn't have presets, that all the sounds were electronic, would be something used. And this would be the time when Dopefer actually started making Eurorack, and nobody cared. It was a very difficult sell. In fact, at the Music Mesa show this year, he told me that he had to fight to get into the booth at the Music Mesa show when he had his product, and then after fighting with them, they would put him in the back of the booth where no one could even get to it. And of course now, in the Alex Ford booth at Music Mesa, Dopefer has the biggest section and is very successful. But it was a fight for the analog synthesizer to make its way back into usage, in actively usage by some of the users, the people who are actually making music professionally. But in the 90s, all the other options that were that type of thing, like the Quasi-MIDI Revolution 309, was just a campy joke. It was a preset machine that was being pitched to people to paint by numbers, to make kitschy imitations of electronic music that without knowing what you're doing. So that would essentially push us into the modern era, I'd say, which I feel like the line in the sand was that Ableton Live was invented in 2002 or whatever it was, and pretty much everything in electronic music was changed into being done with a plug-in, a laptop, a loop, these kinds of things, the opposite of everything that I'd grown up using to make music. And the music itself changed into being created almost like the sound of the music was derived from the tools that were being used to make it. So no longer was the sound design really a part of the artistic process. Now it's about like assembling a library, it's about collecting sounds, about downloading them, in the same way that consuming music had become about collecting as many free MP3s as possible, but maybe not even ever listening to any of them. That had become what getting your sounds together was, just trying to collect as many as you can, like they're baseball cards, even, you know, more than you could ever use. And my contention, and really the point of what this is supposed to be about, is about how I would like to know how we as manufacturers, or we as users, can win techno back as a genre that's supposed to be a synthesizer genre. It's supposed to be a culture of using synthesizers, and I feel like it's as much on the responsibility, or it's as much on the makers of the synths as it is on the makers of the music, because there's a reason why they fell out of touch with each other. And the number one thing that I'm always preaching, that, you know, everybody's probably bored of hearing me say, is that interface. Every instrument should be designed from the outside in. When you think of an instrument from the perspective of the musician, you shouldn't actually care how the sound is being made. That's why I said at the beginning, I'd like to eliminate analog from the equation. The synths that I make now for the market are analog, but I can't promise that they will be, and it doesn't really matter. What matters is that when I look at the device, it inspires me to do something with it, and I intuitively understand how to do something with it, that if I just reach out and touch something, that it's going to do something that makes sense to me. And we have to remember that we're not making tools, and we're not making art of our own. We're making instruments for creating art. So the most important thing for the synthesizer designer is to try to get into the head of the artist who might use it to make something. I think that I have, as a synthesizer designer, a unique perspective, having been a recording artist on my own before I was designing synthesizers, because I, of course, create from the outside in, like I said, but I create what I really want to use in making music. I don't create something that I feel like the marketplace really needs. I create something that I think I really need as a musician, and then I'm presented with the responsibility of trying to convince the rest of the world that they also need it. And in case anybody hasn't seen it, this is my synthesizer that I'm showing the show. And I told him I didn't need to plug it in because this is more about me talking than anything else. But we've had a lot of talk about, at my booth, about the aesthetics, about how it looks nice, which I'm happy that it looks nice, but my goal is that it doesn't look nice, that it looks very functional as an instrument, that it is something that makes people want to make music with it. And I'm happy if it's fun and that it's like, you know, seems like a toy that inspires people to play around. But what I really want is for something to come from it, that it's inspiring people to actually create and complete. So I'd be willing, not willing, I would like to open this as a discussion. I would like to talk about what there could be in the world of synthesizers that could make, you know, my music or the music that I come from relate better to the device, or that could make this actually work, this relationship a little bit more functional, rather than always like a confusion where I talk to people who make techno and they say, oh, modulars, I don't do that, that's too complicated, or those are expensive, or I don't know how to use that, it's not for me, I want to and use loops, or I use presets, or use a library, because to me there's no reason to use a preset sound on the synthesizer, because if you know what you're doing with it, getting to the sound that you imagine is always possible. You don't have to hit a button and get someone else's vision. You can actually understand the possibilities and then explore the possibilities. So that, if that's the end of this, then it's probably pretty short. But I guess it's important to me that we save the synthesizer. I think everybody here probably agrees with that, because that's why we're here, for Knobcon. But I do have any questions about anything? I mean, can I? Yes?
You mentioned downwards earlier, Mark, and that Birmingham techno sound is a very identifiable sound for me. I like it.
Yeah.
The sound the surgeon does, and I know that he particularly is a big Ableton user, but I also know for a fact that he's dabbling in modular now. And can you comment on a prediction on where you see that going? Because he's utilizing modulars, he's on the road, he's touring, which I think is a stumbling point for some people, taking modulars on the road and doing, you know, I mean, that.
Well, there's a really interesting distinction to be made of artists who make music in their studio, but when they go out on the road, all they ever do is DJ, because ultimately, like, the size or how cumbersome the devices they're using to make the music is irrelevant if they're not taking it out on the road. But I think that you pretty much universally will find that people who do travel and play live shows will complain about anything bigger than a laptop, because once they've tasted the ease of carrying something under their arm onto the plane, they don't want to bring, you know, two flight cases and pay extra baggage and whatever. But I know that, I can't speak for what the surgeon is doing now, but I know that during the 90s era, the heyday of the Birmingham sound, those guys were all using analog synths and really creating their music sort of live to dat the same way that, most of the people around me in the Midwest were doing. But by the end of the 90s, I those guys had become kind of loop jockeys, or like, you know, I think at the time they were really into using Acid, the you know, loop software. So I hear a rumor that Surgeon has contacted Snazzy FX about how he's been using some of the modules. So clearly he's using something Eurorack. I don't know what's in his system, but I think it's pretty common for guys my age, or I think that Surgeon's roughly my age, like around 40, I would say. And I think that the guys who've done this for that long have gone through several eras in what they're doing, and they probably went with the times a bit and got into computers and plugins and laptops and all of this, and then at some point just felt like they didn't have any inspiration. They were sitting in front of a screen all day long every day and really, really missed putting their hands on something and feeling it getting warm and reaching out and turning something. So I guess my comment on the direction of that is that maybe the best that we in this camp can hope for is that the cycles of trends in the way that the gear is, and the cycles of the trends in what people are doing with music and other cycles that work in this will coincide in such a way that the bitterness of adulthood, the coming back of interest in hardware synthesizers, and the changes in what people are doing musically will all coincide, and that we'll see some of those guys get on board. I mean, I talked to Steve Stoll downstairs, who's, you know, been doing this longer than me, and I talked to Stefan Roberts, who was in Acid Junkies, and he was at Music Mesa talking to me about how he is using Eurorack, and he's working, had yet gotten any of mine, but was interested in it. So I think that there's a for every person, there's a cycle where they start to really get into all these devices, and then after a while, they start to feel owned by a huge pile of equipment and want to get rid of some of it to try to simplify, and then they realize that they really preferred to have something tactile and inspiring. I don't know if that answers that question. Yes?
I have a question. I guess your modules are like influenced by Buchla quite a bit. Do you feel like you share some of their philosophy about the way it's designed, or do you feel like there's certain things that they do?
I've had a couple of really interesting conversations with Don Buchla, but I wouldn't say that he was a teacher of mine exactly. But I was initially, my introduction into synthesizer electronics was working for Grant Richter, the Wired music guy who does designs for Maleko now, and he was the guy who repaired pretty much all the vintage Buchla systems in the 80s, because in the early 80s, when everybody lost interest in modulars, all the universities that had Buchla systems pretty much just had them collecting dust, and he was interested in them because he was too young to get one, and they were insanely expensive. I mean, you think they're expensive now. In the 70s, a big Buchla system in the, like, 1973, the system as big as mine was $30,000, which was enough to buy a house. So by the 80s, most of what he collected from universities in California, they flat out gave to him. So when I went over to his place in like 94 or something, he had a museum of synthesizers and a 50 space Buchla 200 and a music easel and several other things. And everybody who had one somehow would find their way to him to repair them. So during that period when I was essentially interning for him and soldering wires on pots and, you know, talking, he was getting these modules and fixing them. So he'd get a music easel and have it on his workbench opened up, and he'd have his music easel opened up next to it, comparing them. And working on a vintage boob was like an archaeological dig, because he made so few of them, and they were made one at a time, that every single one that went out the door had different mods done to it, and there's no notation on the schematic. And sometimes within a low-pass gate, there are three different circuits between the four different low-pass gates in the module. So I learned a lot about electronics, and I learned a lot about buklas from him. And then as time went on, he essentially passed the torch to me, and I became the guy who was fixing all the buklas that were out, the old ones that were out there. And that led to me, during the time when I was working for him, I was already obsessed with the buklas, but I didn't own one, and I didn't do the work myself. I was just with him. But I studied the schematics like they were a Bible. So by the time that I started repairing them for other people in maybe 2004, a lot of the designs, I could have drawn the schematic from memory. I was just, you know, really deeply into it. So I'd done, during that time since 2004, I'd done a lot of custom work, or one-off modules, or small run custom parts for Google users. And I brought a lot of the ideas that I got from the Buchla, and a lot of the ideas that I brought to the Buchla in my format, into my designs for the Eurorack. In the interview for Sonic State that Alessandro Cortini did, showing off his live rig on the road with Nine Inch Nails, he showed my system that he's using, and he said I like it because it's 50% Buchla, 50% techno. So I think that's a pretty good way to characterize what I bring to this industry, is that the experience that I have working with this obscure, artsy, left-wing and the experience I have through techno and recording engineering to bring together the Buchla philosophy and the techno musicianship, I think. But it was Buchla who said to design from the front panel in. That resonates to me more than anything else. Yeah. Because he even told me himself that if you know what you want it to do, it doesn't matter what's making it do that. You know, it could be a computer, it could be an analog function, it could be anything, as long as you already decided what you want it to do, so you just get it to do that. And that's what's important. And he said that if it's an instrument and not a tool, that there's no such thing as obsolete. Because if the technology, if you believe it doesn't matter how you make it happen, then the technology was irrelevant all along. So 20 years down the road, it still does what it's supposed to do, and that doesn't matter then how. If it was a tool where you created a circuit and then said, okay, well, this is kind of cool, I can put a patch point for every single thing on this circuit in order, and now how do I make a panel for this? I'll just put a ton of jacks here and some knobs between it. That's a different thing than envisioning an instrument and then figuring out how to make that happen. But it's also why Buchla 200 modules are like three boards deep and a rat's nest of chaos. Because they're four times as much circuitry as the same era modules from like ARP or Moog or something. Which also is why they were insanely expensive and made in small quantities. Yep.
Are there any types of, like, so you talk about interface and, you know, people using these kinds of instruments for techno, are there any types of, like, interfaces that you think are missing from the synthesizer world to get, you know, techno artists back into using?
Yeah, well, I think that, like, my philosophy in instrument design is that I would like to never go past one function per control. I don't ever want to have menus. I don't ever want to have things where I have to like push a button a whole bunch of times in order to get to the thing that I'm going to. And part of the reason for that is because I'm a live performer, by nature. So my recorded music is essentially a live performance recorded, and obviously when I'm out in the world performing, it's a live performance. And in that context, I don't feel like you have, I don't think it functions well for you to have to look for something you prepared, like some preset or some like more pre-organized thing. I think that you have to be able to think, you know, on this, I want it to slide on that step, and now it slides on that step. Like, I gotta go to the menu where the slides are, and I think that that's the, overwhelmingly, that's the thing that people lose track of. And I think that part of that is feature creep. Like, everybody, when making a device, can get overwhelmed by the idea of including every possibility and making it so widely functional and so sellable in sort of a like sales pitch way that they want everything to do everything. And I don't think that that makes for good instruments. I think that limitations are actually a part of the success of something, because this can essentially do one thing, but it does it in a way that's so successful that you can't make it do a bad thing. Like, if you're looking for like a, you know, acid-based sound, you can literally just fumble around on it and something will come out that's like maybe gonna be like perfect, you know? Whereas if you had, if this synthesized, there are the controls on this can't be in a bad position. You know, you turn them through this range and every part of it is, you know, usable in some sense. But there are plenty of synthesizers that aren't that at all, that there are lots of positions that the controls could be in that no sound at all would come out of. In fact, in the 90s, that was, you know, a classic story that we tell to each other about the time when, you know, the time when I was in a pawn shop and they had a Pearl 1 and they said, yeah, but it doesn't work. And we plugged it in and I could see that the envelope amount to VCA was all the way down, but they didn't know what that meant, so they thought it didn't work. It doesn't make any sound, so I let them believe that so I could get it for $50. I mean, I think that that the instruments that are very deliberate in what they're doing are better for musicians. I think that when you start to try to give every possibility to the user, you're doing a disservice to them, really, because you sacrifice the grace of the device by, you know, making it sort of a jack of all trades and a master of none. And not to pick on, but like Serge Chereknin, the, you know, Serge Modular designer, he did a really incredible job of he was working at CalArts and they had Buchla labs that were booked for eternity. Nobody could get into them. The machines were so expensive no one could ever own one. And so he had the idea that he wanted to make something with the functions of a Buchla that was cheap. And so in certain cases he would take a Buchla module that had 50 ICs in it and make something using two ICs that could do almost all of those functions. But in that process, it became difficult to use. It became something where you, in order to get it into this mode, you have to patch this to that. And I think that it's really hard for the users to comprehend why they're patching X to Y. And if you can't comprehend if it's magic, then you're just going to have to memorize that patch, which makes it cumbersome and not intuitive and not useful as an instrument. So thereby, you know, negating all of Buchla's mission, you know, because ultimately what Buchla was trying to do wasn't make something that did everything. He was trying to make something that did hardly anything, but really well. Yes?
I'm trying to follow your, not an argument, but your point.
Yeah.
Because it sort of started off with modulars in techno. But we sort of got to the
not
point.
Specifically modulars.
Not
synthesizers.
Okay.
And as opposed to presets or samples or you know, whatever.
Clarified point. Okay. Because I was thinking the modulars are about the furthest thing from convenient. I mean, you know, it's like, it's very difficult to get something you like out of
Absolutely.
A modular.
And that's, I think that that's why there's an interest in closed systems. Like, if you're talking about Buchla's, the fact that there's so much more enthusiasm for the Music Easel than there is for the 200E, I think that that's, and we see a trend even in the Eurorack world toward modules that are essentially complete voices. Hmm. I think that for a lot of people, they don't enjoy starting with an absolutely blank slate that they have to assemble the voice structure in the first place. I mean, really, the introduction to the mini mode is the simplification of the of modular. I mean, if they notice that 75% of the time the users are patching a couple VCOs through a VCF, VCA, and putting envelope generators to it, then they think, well, why? If all these people don't, that's all they're going to do anyway, then why don't we just package it in something where they don't have to do that every time? My product's modular and requires some amount of that, but I think that within the modular context, there's room to position the parameters in such a way that you help nudge along the user toward success. Like, I think we were talking about the harmonic oscillator earlier, about the, it's a huge amount of data that comes out. So this is an oscillator that has individual outputs for all of the first 8 harmonics. And that's additive synthesis, but the problem in additive synthesis is that it's so much content that coming up with a way of going between all these different harmonics becomes a problem. So in my module, by putting circuitry to scan across them or to select them from voltage, I allow what could have been a patch that took a whole modular that would be an achievement to get to happen, turn it into turning a knob. And I think that's part of the interface argument. And I agree with you that the modular is quintessentially the opposite of simplicity. But it doesn't have to be the opposite of musicality. Yes?
With that being said, what about the idea of putting connections on the back of the modules?
For normaling?
For normalization.
I actually was told yesterday that the EMU modular had some sort of blocks on the back for putting in normals, but I was unaware of that.
Wired. Wired and normals.
Built in, but did it have the ability to user create the normals?
No.
Yeah, a lot of people have said that the ultimate modular synthesizer was the ARP 2600, the perfect collection of modules with normals for most of what you would ever do with it built in. So I think there's definitely a place for that. I mean, that probably was the purpose of normals in the first place, was to speed up what you would most of the time want to do with the thing. And I use normals a little bit, but not too much. But you mean like actual connectors, like put mini jacks on the back that you could actually pack cables inside of the box? It's an interesting idea. I know that some manufacturers have headers where they can run like ribbon cables between things to.
Oh, there's the whole preset stuff, like 69. You know, when they first started doing the live shows.
I'm not familiar with that one, but I know that
they basically connected in the back of the module, so then they could select with another control board, you know, how they would connect together. For an instant switch and connection rather than cable in front. That wasn't through the back.
The thing about that is my fear with anything that's user configurable that's too complicated for the users to figure out is that as a designer, you're just wasting your time creating it because no one will ever actually do anything with it. In the Buchla, and the 288 delay, which barely was anything, three of them. There's a section for presets of, it's a machine with eight, it's a delay that has eight taps, and there are actually 16 memories, and the eight taps could be anywhere in those 16 memories. So there is a section where that could be configured into three different presets, collections. And then there's a section with four mixes of the eight DDA converters, like for preset mixes. And I'm pretty sure that all of the ones that he made never had either of those presets configured, because it would have involved making some sort of jumpers and resistors in order to do it. It's just outside of the realm of a user. I mean, it's almost like expecting that whoever buys your device to be like on the level that you're on. I mean, if they're at the level where they could be doing those presets, they could be just making their own module from the beginning, I think. I mean, for me, getting away from presets is a good thing, but creating interfaces that are intuitive enough that the preset is really in our mind, in the sense that we know how to get to what we want so intuitively that we don't need to store something in order to get it back again.
I know you were talking about more, you're trying to focus more on the musicality of your instrument. Like down the road, do you see yourself maybe coming up with different types of small compact systems, like where you would put out more modules and then they would kind of be interchangeable?
It definitely seems that the marketplace likes systems packaged rather than open-ended. I think that a lot of people, especially when they're getting into synthesizers, don't feel comfortable picking out what's going to be in their system, and they say to the dealer, can you tell me what to get? And if the manufacturer presents them with a, not necessarily a closed system, but a complete set, or this is the definitive starter set or something like that, they like that because they're afraid of themselves, because you know they don't know enough, they haven't used it yet, so they're learning. But the guys from Schneidersladen told me that they no longer sell the Dofer basic set in a case where every space is filled by a module, because inevitably a month down the road the users come back and say, now I really want this other filter and I have nowhere to put it. So they sell it in a box that's two rows of 84 HP with blanks in the second row, expecting the users to come back and want more. And of course it's a disease. You know, once you bought one, you know, it's like, you know, a drug addiction. So
No idea.
I will actually be packaging systems, but I don't know that I'll be packaging like multiple levels of systems. And I don't build the box that's in is actually built by a woodworker in Brooklyn. It's a rough process for us to actually present it as a product, because he's charging a lot of money for it and it has no power supply. So I have to build a power supply. And by the time I'm able to sell you a box, it costs more than I wanted to pay for it from him. It's like, it's ridiculous. I mean, it's too much money. And so I can't, if I have to pay so much to get it, then I can't really, you know, package anything in a way that is practical for anybody. So we're trying, but unless I get into the case business, I don't know how that's going to pan out.
So does that mean you don't envision like adding another module to the current system that you have?
The keyboard will be in production soon. I have several more designs that are you know, prototype level. Okay. So theoretically, I should have modules coming at a steady trickle.
Getting back towards your theme, you're in New York now?
Yeah.
So have you, obviously you know other people making techno music, dance music, have you tried, like, you know, hey, well, I know you love your Ableton and whatever, but try this device, you know, like, or, you know, let me work with you for a while, like, what what experience do you have like trying to introduce it to people? Because it's obviously hard to step away from like, look, this worked, it's good enough, the listeners can't tell the difference, especially by the time it's in MP3 in their earbuds and
I don't think I would sell the synthesizer idea based on how much better it sounds. I do like the sound of the things that I make, but I don't think that the finished song that you could listen to it and tell me if it was a plug-in or a synth. I think that it's the experience of using it, and I think that we make the decisions about what we use based on what makes us feel good.
Yeah, and I didn't mean to take it into a sound.
As far as pitching the idea of using this instead of that to my contemporaries, when I do collaborations, people come in to my studio usually to work with me, and I do try to pass the sickness on to them, but they generally, people who come into my studio generally say, like, wow, this guy's crazy. I mean, like, they want to go to the world and talk about how insane it is, not about how inviting it is. So I think that the lesson that I have to learn is how to open this up to make it more inviting to people who are not users. And they tell me that Eurorack has grown 20% a year for the last 10 years, so in users, but I think it's grown 20% a year in manufacturers too. So you know, we do have to try to welcome new users and try to convert people to being synthesizer users. But it's a little bit like religious evangelism. You gotta be really careful that you don't sell it so hard that you actually turn them off.
Right. Well, you raised a couple of common objections. You know, it's complicated and it's expensive, and there's not really any getting around that.
In New York, they usually say, I don't have space for this.
Yeah.
Yes.
Are there software instruments or, like, kind of, that you are excited about? I mean, in terms of, like, expression, or that are inviting, that don't sort of fall prey to, like, the menu trap?
It's really hard.
Like, how do you see, like, software developing, or, you know, sort of engaging this more?
Well, historically, the pitch from the software developers is, you can use this hardware controller and you can configure this to go to that, and this go to that. But I never really felt like that inspired me. I felt like it was still massively disconnected, that I'm like moving this unlabeled fader over here and which one was which, and it's a little hard for me to get invested in. I use plugins when I work on projects that are not, you know, necessarily mine to drift off into noodling around with synthesizers to see what happens, where I just, you know, now we need a, you know, square wave lead here doing this. I'll use a plugin for that, because I think that there isn't any synthesis to be done, really, or something like that. As far as inspiration's concerned, I think that I'm a Pro Tools user for my things that I engineer and produce, and there was in the instrument packet that was like the Pro, you know, the Air instrument pack, they released one not that long called Loom, which is an additive synthesizer, and I have a hard time figuring out how to get through the programming, but it's really incredible what you can do with something that's not practical in hardware. Additive is a really good example, especially when you get into, like, you know, 1,000 harmonics or something. The software does a really good job because it can give you displays showing 1,000 harmonics, and it can do things like let you draw in harmonic mixes or blend, stuff that is not practical with hardware, that I haven't figured out a way to do with a hardware thing. But as far as like software that emulates a piece of hardware, I'm not crazy about them. I mean, occasionally I've used something like the Korg Legacy Collection Poly 6 because I knew what I wanted was a bland Poly 6 type string sound. I didn't have to really reinvent the wheel. I just wanted this sound or the Mellotron plugin or something like that.
I guess I was thinking almost more of an extension versus like an emulation, like something new that like hardware can't do, or
yeah,
like
I think
the way you engage.
Yeah, I think the additive one is a good example of that, but I don't have a lot of examples of that. I feel like there must be more that could be done. It's kind of interesting if you think about the early days of digital synthesizers that in the 80s when the, you know, the only option was like a Synclavier, a Fairlight, or a couple of Moog instruments like the 400 and the Touche, that the way that they treated being a digital synthesizer was so different than the way that we treat it now, because the tendency now is for them to present it like you're looking at a picture of a hardware synthesizer on the screen, rather than exploit the things that the computer can do better than hardware.
Right.
And there are things, because you can do, you know, envelopes with an infinite number of stages, or you can do and that's somewhere that they excelled in. You know, they could have graphic interfaces that show that it would be really hard to do in hardware. FM synthesis, I think that the native instruments FM7 and FM8 are superior to, you know, using a DX7, because the interface of a DX7 was such crap. Being able to have it up on the screen and see some of the parameters and display for them is really helpful.
Some of your objections seem to be about the user interface, like say, you know, move this unlabeled knob on your MIDI controller box, but we're getting more and more into, you know, multi-touch interfaces now.
It's true.
Tablets and laptops even.
An iPad can probably do a better job of acting as a controller for a soft synth, or acting as the soft synth itself, than could ever have been done by like a PVPC 1600 connected to your computer. You know, it's like it's really hard sometimes, particularly like instrument, you know, a slider that is sending a continuous controller, but if you had to update something in the computer, it doesn't change the slider. You know, it's motorized maybe, but it's a hard thing for me, and I'm in a lot of ways really unashamedly old school, that I don't like synths with a whole bunch of knobs that have presets, because it drives me crazy that I look down and the arrow's pointing here and actually it's playing over here, and until I touch it and pass that, you know, it's not showing me what I like or what I hear. So, you know, there's a long way to go in that. I think that when the Nord Lead 3 came out with the continuous encoders with LEDs around them, and it gave you visual feedback for where the parameters were, I think that was a massive step forward. Unfortunately, it was pretty expensive for what it was, and it's just expensive to do that all at the time.
Yeah.
So how do you make these selections when you're designing? I assume it's only you doing the design order of trade-off between, you know, how much it's going to cost, do what you want to do versus...
Yeah, that's true. I think that, well, it's funny how the cost, you know, in a module or a synth, the cost is all wrapped up in the physical portion of it, like in the panel controls and the panel itself and the knobs and all of that. The electronics that are on the circuit board are at most 10% of the cost of the whole unit. Yeah. So generally speaking, I don't think that the cost addition of a feature being added or tweaked to be the way that it really feels like it should be, I don't think that generally is a limiting factor. I don't think that I ever make the decision, I really wanted to do this, but that'll cost an extra $3, so I'm not going to do it. I would never do that. However, you know, at some point, these things, just like I said before, like you can be become bloated with features, which ultimately bogs down the interface. Well, it can be bloated with features that ultimately bogs down or weighs down the cost of creating it to a point where the retail price would be stupid and nobody would ever buy it. Yeah, you just have to try to balance it, like how important is this or how important is that. But my stuff tends to be a little bit on the expensive side, and that's because I don't care. I would rather make it the way that I want it to be and have it too expensive than compromise it so that I can get it, you know, into more people's hands.
So how do you make a selection of your suppliers for your components?
Oh, well, part of that is, you mean for the panel components or for like ICs and passives? You know, I know what part I want to use. I can just compare, like use findchips.com, and it'll search all the suppliers that have it and give me the price for all of them. So I can, you know, use that to find the cheapest and easiest way to get it. As far as the stuff that creates the look and feel of the interface, I mean, I dreamed up what these would be in Illustrator, drawing up mock-ups and printing them out like onto paper and putting knobs on top of the printouts and moving them around to where that they seemed like I could live with them. You know, I could have them right in front of me and say, if this is here, how does that feel to me, to see how close together these are or whatever.
Yeah.
And at the beginning phase of starting my line, I had to make certain commitments, like, you know, I'm going to use this. This is a big knob, and this is a small knob. And once that decision is in stone, that's pretty much where I am for at least for a while. You know,
yeah.
And as far as like the look and feel of mine, obviously the use of the knobs that I'm using is a shameless nod to the '70s Buchla stuff, because the knobs are made by the same company, Rogan, here in Chicago, but they're not the same colors that Buchla used. So it's like a, you know, sort of like tip of the hat. But then I also I've always preferred sliders as an interface for sequencers or envelope generators or mixers, because they're a visual representation. So I searched out sliders that had a good feel and would work for what I was trying to do. And then I just basically, you know, had things that I liked when I was using them. I wanted to feel those controls that way. I wanted stuff that was solid, and I wanted pots that felt smooth and were conductive plastic and better quality. So I guess a lot of the decision, all of those decisions were based on my childlike desire to have this thing that I think is cool, and then the hope that my taste about what is cool or what's inspiring, that other people agree with me on that. And you know, graphic design, I feel like the simpler the better, and really clear and clean. The most significant control on a module is you probably have the biggest knob. Like, the, you know, on a filter, you put the cutoff as the big knob because that's the one that you're reaching out and grabbing the most.
Yeah.
Stuff like, and you know, the spacing between things, you try to make those decisions based on what looks balanced, but also like if you're, you know, working on this thing, you know, it just feels like, yeah, that, I can get to that, and you know, in a dark room when I'm, you know, three drinks in or whatever, you know, it's like, it's all part of a living with the instrument. So there's like, in the world of electronics, they call it DFM, design for manufacture. So you have that you have to make your device manufacturable. So decisions like what size surface mount parts you're going to use, or you know, the part's going to be on the top or the bottom, and all that kind of stuff. You make those decisions based on how it's going to be built and how buildable it is. But the decisions about what's on the outside are entirely based on look and feel, for me anyway.
Do you try to test them as much as you can down the road?
Yeah, I at this point I'm using this system in every performance that I do.
Cool.
And I make a prototype version that has the panel laid out like it will be, not paint, not a texture powder coat and color the way that it will be, but physically laid out the way that it will be to try it out so that I can potentially have to revise it.
Are you using any rapid manufacturing processes for various things?
To do the temporary panel?
Yeah.
I use Front Panel Express.
Okay.
But I mean, they're kind of expensive, but they're, you know, reliable.
Okay. That's cool.
Yes?
Hi, Mark. I don't know why he was not.
The heckling begins.
All right, so big question. So back in the day, we all came from like a lot of hardware, right?
Yeah.
Tables full of fucking hardware. Prototype 909, like all this stuff. So everything got condensed down into like software, right? Condense it.
Yeah.
So originally before that was modular. So like, I'm just wondering like the larger question of coming from like a table full of gear to software, or from modular to hardware and then back to modular again. Is this just a, like a condensed form of like in terms of like performance wise, for live performance, like why are we moving back to this condensed format? Is it a smaller representation of like analog and real control? Is this an emulation of software, but it's tangible? Like, why are we moving back from small to large? Like, just kind of your general thoughts on like the whole progression of like multiple pieces of 30 pieces of gear hooked up with MIDI and in sync versus something like this that's in a rack.
Well, a table full of small independent devices that are all self-contained on their own is in a way similar to a big modular, but
yeah, exactly.
But I don't think that we're necessarily going back to big. I feel like in a way, I mean, this is a condensed format. I mean, this box that I'm using isn't any more big and cumbersome than 909.
Yeah. So, are we moving forward or are we moving back? Or are we just
I think we're moving in some sideways direction.
Okay.
Because really what we're doing in the Eurorack world is,
yeah,
we're, at least what I'm doing, a lot of the technology that's on the schematic is very much old world. It's 70s style. But the technology that's manufactured is very much of the moment. It's small surface mount, and it's automated assembly, and it's modern. So this wouldn't have been possible to make like this in the 70s. So it's not a reissue or a rehashing. It's actually like a, what do they call it, in Back to the Future, when something's,
yeah,
been like a separate path, and it's like, you know, we're trying it again, but like in a different way. I think that the value of what's out there in Eurorack now is the fact that there are a lot of options. So you could choose to do a modular that is all unrelated pieces, or you could choose modules that are largely integrated systems on their own. There are plenty of modules that are whole synthesizer, just one module. So in a way, that would enable you to replace that whole table full of gear with one box like this that had a handful of more integrated modules. So there aren't rules, you know. We aren't really going in any direction. We're going in all sorts of directions. It's a good time for users because this stuff is vastly more affordable than it ever was. And the information is out there, because I can't imagine what it would have been like to buy a synthesizer that was insanely expensive and you couldn't even find out anything about it. Like in, you know, in the 70s, it would have been really difficult to get any information, and it would be really difficult to afford it. Now, the internet will tell you anything you ever want to know, and they cost a tenth of what they did back then.
Cool.
Yeah.
last night when you played, were you doing any sort of post-processing, Mark? Were you running straight out of the gear and into your mixer?
I had an effects processor with reverb.
You know, coming from a live techno, like what you did, and doing like rave parties, to some degree, whether it was only psychologically, I always was in a competition with a DJ who was playing something off a record, which was fully recorded and post-processed. And of course, I'm bringing out drum machines and synths and basically running into a Mackie 12 or 16 channel mixer and then maybe reverb and compression. It sounded like live music as opposed to what happened later where you mentioned with sample-based stuff, sampling a record and processing the shit out of it, and all of a sudden you have a user record. You have Swedish techno massively compressed.
Yeah, well, I think that a huge portion of that is in the mastering. I mean, it could be argued that era of techno records were as much to be credited to like Mills, mastering engineer in England, as to the guys who, you know, were listed as the artists. I mean, a huge portion of you know, really loud banging techno was the mastering. But you have the option of sending your signal through some sort of aggressive multiband compressor and maximizer. I mean, you probably weren't doing that, but it's funny because I feel like just as many people said to me, you know, it's weird, it just like never has the impact that a record does, as it's amazing how much the sound system just opened up when you started. It was like your kick drum was double the size of those records. So, you know, I don't really have the answer. It's like magic, I think. And part of the thing is that when you press music to vinyl, it has an additional like compression element where everything kind of gets mushed together into a big fat blob that I think to most people sounds really desirable for what it is. So I can give you no advice.
Will techno be live, more live than in the past?
I think there is more live techno now than there was back in the day. And I think if you talk to Steve back there, he would tell you that he was, you know, for a long time doing live shows and not DJing, as was I, and pretty much looked around to be the only ones doing that. I mean, there was a time, particularly during that time when this just doesn't sound as compressed and huge and loud as that does, when that was the number one concern, it was pretty rare to be a guy who was live. And if you know, a lot of who was live at that point was essentially just canned, like coming out of some, you know, free put together, you know, all samples or loops or something that, you know, didn't have the risk that putting a bunch of synthesizers somewhere did.
And I think you made a really good point there, because I always made the distinction of, I'm not a DJ, I did DJ for years. You know, my agent said, oh, it gets you a lot of work, you don't have to carry those flight cases around at all.
Yeah.
But, I bet you can talk about the distinction between the DJ and the actual producer.
Yeah, we probably agree on this one. In the height of my living off of making techno records and touring, where I did plenty of DJing too, but if anyone ever said, you know, oh, you DJs, I feel need to correct that, because I think that there are DJs who want to get more DJ gigs, so they figure out a way to put out a record because they think it'll, you know, expand their name around the world and get them more gigs. And those are usually the people who are coming to us asking us to make the music for them. And then there are producers who get suckered into DJing to promote their music. So I was definitely the producer or live act who did some DJing with the intention of promoting my music. But I think that there are tools out there that border on making the music for you that are really appealing to people who don't have musical background, but they have DJing background, or they have music listener background. They have a really good ear for what works, or they have a really vast library in their minds of all of the great records that have ever been made. And those kinds of people, they make the kind of producers like an Arthur Baker type producer who like sits on the couch in the back of the room and once in a while says, that's great, I love it, and that's producing the record, versus the kind that I was that I came up as like as a, an intern in a recording studio and learning to engineer, thinking someday I'm gonna produce a famous band. And unfortunately, the world doesn't really care about if you're a good engineer. Like most of the biggest producers in the world are people who had some industry connection that got them that job. So from the I don't know what the point of that all was, but it's definitely true that the sound of a recording, particularly record, a vinyl record, versus the sound of the same instruments just plugged into the sound system is very different, and it has to do with compression, but it's all wrapped up in the same thing as why people record drums on tape and then bounce it into Pro Tools. They like the natural compression of hitting the tape, and vinyl does the same thing because a needle can only move so fast and in so many ways. So it has a, we're essentially, to make a record and then play the record, it's essentially like, a chamber reverb, you're converting it to acoustic energy and then back to electrical energy. So there's just something in that process that is different than a purely electronic signal going directly from the electronics to the sound system. I mean, when you're making electronic music using analog synthesizers, the first time that has ever actually been a sound is when it comes out of the speaker in front of these people. Whereas, in a recording, even if the recording was electronic, it has gone through this process of being, from here to there, and it has gone, it's been moving coils and changing things, changing itself on the way. So I don't have the answer.
Something else. Okay. Because we're talking about, going to laptops, and I went to laptop, I don't know, when Ableton first came out. To me, there's just, it's not as satisfying playing those shows with the computer, although you have it set up and it might sound great coming out. There's the tactile thing of actually working the machines and being on the fly, just being able to change things up. And I think as a performer, that's a hell of a lot more satisfying than hitting a space bar to start your set. And,
of course. And well,
through your clips.
Yeah, there must be a way to use software like that and some sort of controller interface and allow every possibility that you dream up and feel connected to it in a way that
is natural. I just always thought at some point this computer is going to take shit on me. Now it's happened before,
Yeah, well, that's definitely an issue. And I think that the superstars, the people who are way out of our realm, like Nine Inch Nails has all of the electronics backstage are running in absolute duplicate. So at any moment, if there's a problem, they can flip a switch to the one that isn't having a problem.
Right.
And we've never had that option. Plenty of times I'd set up to do a show, and it's like a hot, loud club, and I'm trying to figure out why these machines won't stay in sync with each other. And switching cables and retrying, the power. Maybe we plug it into this other outlet, it'll start working. And usually, pretty much always, we found some solution, but totally different world, and that's
at least you had one thing running still. Not all the music is
right.
I think that's all. It must all be part of why you choose to use what you choose to use, because you create a relationship with it, and as if you use a synthesizer for a long time, I always pick on the SH-101 because it's so predictable that if I dreamed up a sound, if I thought what a sound I needed, I could put the sliders into them where they needed to be to get that sound without even listening.
Yeah.
and that's just about building a relationship with the instrument. And if you never have an energy with it where you look at it positively, if you look at the laptop with disdain, then you're never going to really enjoy using it. And I unfortunately think that if you're not enjoying yourself, it's pretty hard for anyone else to enjoy it. So it's like as soon as you start hating what you're doing, it's the beginning of your failure, And the whole reason you got into it was because had something to say or because you enjoyed doing it. I try to always preach the theory of process oriented thinking, that there is no prize at the end of any of this stuff. You know, the prize is the fact that you can do it. So you know, if you're looking for a payout, you might be disappointed even if you sell out. Anyone else?
Not just a quick one. Again, back to your theme, maybe the fact that a synth, it's never, you're never gonna have to worry, is it compatible with your laptop's OS upgrade, or is the manufacturer gonna produce an update that'll run on the new version of your OS?
I agree with that. I keep telling people that you don't buy plugins, you rent them, because when the new version of your software comes up, the plugin may or may not work with that new version. They may or may not choose to update it, and it doesn't matter that you paid them. You go on to no longer having the thing that you bought. They can never take the synthesizer away from you.
Yeah, as a Pro Tools user, I know how it is when there's an OS upgrade. You have to wait for them to put Pro Tools out on. Then you have to wait for the plugin manufacturers to catch up. It's a nightmare.
Well, they get hell for that all the time, but I prefer that they drag their feet and make sure that everything is working before they
launch.
Although it bums me out, the transition to the AAX plugin format meant that a lot of the sketchy fly-by-night companies didn't come along, so it was, a change. Okay.
Thanks.
All right, thanks.